Sorry, that was the first time I saw that. That was, sorry. I'm Damien Holbrook from TV Guide Magazine.
Woo!
Everyone know it? All right. All right, so you seem to be as excited about that clip as I am now. As someone named Damien, I kind of take some pride in this. But I also had a horrible childhood listening to all of the Omen jokes. So you guys are here to, you're getting into so much stuff today because you're gonna be the first people to hear a lot of stuff that's being talked about this new show. It is apparently very scary, as we just saw, incredibly stylish, and it is probably gonna piss some people off. So you gotta love that, right? I'm gonna bring out our panel and we're gonna get right to it. First, we have creator and executive producer, Glen Mazzara. Bradley James, who stars as and Barbara Hershey, who stars as Anne Rutledge. All right. Hello, guys. Thanks for being here. All right, Glen, first question. I have to ask, so you have created a show that you see it as a direct sequel to the original film.
Yes, that's right.
So how many versions or ideas did you have as to where you could take this character without basically relying on the other two sequels?
Oh, that's a great question. When I was originally approached by Fox to develop this character, it was originally the idea of one of our executive producers, Ross Feynman. And he said, well, how about a show based on The Omen? I said, great, I love the first movie, but the second and third movie kind of pushed Damien along this particular, character arc. And I love that kid, that scary kid, and I want to know what happened to him maybe 25 years later. And one of the ways that I wanted to approach it, Fox bought into it, was, when we meet Damien, he's 30. And the reason we're doing that is because he's, Christ started his journey when he was 30. So this is an anti-Christ, and we're sort of taking that Jesus story and flipping it on its head, which I'm sure is going to piss some people off. But it was kind of a very different way to go, and that's where we started from.
And what has this guy been up to since we saw him knocking his mother off the balcony?
He's been up to a lot of trouble. He's been up to, we're going to learn that. I think he's been living a very interesting life. And we're gonna meet him, when he's 30. We're gonna understand what he's been up to. But he has to, as certain events happen in season one, he has to go back and revisit things and say, oh, that's what that was about. That's what that meant. So I think fans are gonna be excited to not only follow his story, but also go back and be able to fill in where he's been those past 25 years.
And you're clearly, from the clip, we're seeing scenes from the original film. So are we acknowledging that this, Lee Remick was his adopted mother and all that?
Yeah, we're using that mythology. I mean, I'm a huge fan of that original film. And, it's a great starting point. It's a classic film. And so we're being very respectful to it. And all of the characters and events that happen in that film are things that are still having repercussions throughout our show.
Okay. And this was originally planned to be on Lifetime.
Yes.
Now it's on A&E, which makes so much more sense. why the switch?
You know what? I'll say, I'll give it to Lifetime because they, read the script. It was kind of a crazy script, and they loved it. And, there was an executive there, Nina Lederman, who really kind of said, this is something I want on this network. And then I guess that for different corporate reasons, they felt, it would be a great match with Bates, Bates Motel, and it would be a better fit on A&E. But I'm happy to say that there's been no creative shift. Nina and the other executives are still involved with the show, and they've been incredibly supportive of the story we're setting out to tell. So that's been, when we switched, it wasn't like we had to retool the show or whatever. People are just saying, this is the show these guys are making, and A&E is a better place for it.
Okay, so when we first met Damien, he was obviously a little devil.
He still is.
But it seems like from the clip and from what we've talked about is that he's actually a nice guy.
Wow. you want to take that? How so? Hello, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us. I would say that we all, in some capacity, hold the ability to be a nice guy or girl. Damien is one of us, and so you see that element to his character, but equally, as we all do, we have the ability to not be so nice. I wouldn't say it's as... I think you're touching on something that is... The character isn't black and white, it's various shades of interesting grey.
Yeah, the character has a lot of humanity, and what's been great about the way Bradley's playing him is we see all these different layers. And, you know, if it was just, you know, one thing and not another, I didn't think we would have a long life. And hopefully this is something that people fall in love with these characters, they come back season after season, but we have a long story to tell, and to do that we needed a really complex character, and Bradley's done a great job of bringing that character to life.
And this is a character who, as opposed to the sequel Damien's, is not truly aware of who he is.
No, he's putting it together, and what's been fun about the show is no matter what he does, things just get worse. So it's been a lot of fun to write. I'm really enjoying this one.
Okay. Great. And casting the son of the devil cannot be easy. It's probably fun as hell, no pun intended. But so what was it about Bradley when he came in? Did you say like, oh yes, he's the son of a jackal?
That's exactly what we're looking for. That's exactly what we said. We saw 666 actors. and a lot of them were very talented, but only Bradley James came in and just was, that was the guy. As soon as we saw it, we were like, that's the guy.
Bradley, what was your audition like?
I did a tape originally. I was busy in Vancouver. I couldn't get away for a bit.
You were doing iZombie.
I was doing iZombie. And I just managed to sort of piece this tape together and send it off the back of the enthusiasm that I had for this script. And then, I just sort of found myself I had like one day off where they were able to get me and these two other guys, one who I play football with.
Now, football or soccer?
Football.
Okay.
Soccer, if you're... I won't finish that. And I met sort of, you know, all the faces behind this great script and saw... Passion's a very generic word, but... sort of summed it up. There was just such a clear, you know, thought process from these people of what the story they wanted to tell, and it just got me incredibly excited about the whole thing, and very pleased when I was told I would be doing it.
It's very different from playing like King Arthur. Little girl. How has it been like developing this character with Glen and finding those shades of humanity versus monstrous inhumanity?
Versus?
Monstrous inhumanity.
Inhumanity.
He is the son of the devil.
He is. I feel like already he's severely misunderstood. There's people cheering for him in the next room. It's a good sign. Devil worshippers in there. I think it's. I guess I just speak from behalf of an actor's viewpoint. There, you're approaching a character as you would any other, and you find out as much as you can about him. You find out about his desires. You find out about his problems. You find out what he tries to do to solve those problems, and you create the character. And working with Glen, it's a collaboration. You have extreme freedom to come up with ideas and
present them and work on them together, and that is a rare, beautiful, wonderful situation to be in as an actor.
Where does the 666 birthmark go?
Where does it go?
Because it's cable.
It stays the same. For those of you who've seen the film, it's on the back of Damien's head when he's 5 years old. It's probably not moved too far away.
All right, so Barbara, this was great. Seeing, and it was only a brief sizzle reel, but it seems like your character is not a great influence on this young man.
Well, not yet. She's trying. She's been an influence without me knowing it. She's been there all along, and she's been in the shadows guiding the situation and protecting him from all of these elements that want to destroy him or absorb him or make him theirs. And there are a lot of forces in play that she's protecting him from as well as she can.
And without spoiling anything, is this woman connected to anyone from the original film? Like, are we gonna find out she was at the birthday party when the nanny went a little crazy?
She's been in the shadows all along.
All right. Okay, so you played Mary Magdalene. And now you are playing someone who Mary Magdalene probably would not get along with. How is it being on the other side of the battle versus good and evil?
Well, it's interesting because one of the things I love about Glen's writing and the writers and the whole concept about the series is it's provocative. There are a lot of ideas in it that are really interesting. And so I don't know if she would kind of characterize herself that way. There are a lot of things going on, not all of them bad, which makes her more powerful in a way. Because she's a whole being.
Mm-hmm. And she is a human, correct?
Yes. Okay. I asked, that was my first question to Glen.
These are questions you sometimes have to ask.
Yes.
And Glen told me that something that when he works with actors, there's a relationship where you guys are collaborative, that it's a very important situation. How is that for you guys, being, working with the creator of the show on these things? Like, was that an appeal to you to do the show?
Oh, yeah. He's tremendous to work with, and it's like throwing a creative ball back and forth. You know, it's really stimulating and gets your juices flowing, and, it's complimentary and wonderful.
Yeah.
I was very intrigued to... Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was about to say, I was very intrigued to meet the mind behind the script that
I read
initially, because I thought this guy's going to be, just... straightjacket or something like that. So, and he was when I first met him.
So, without spoiling anything, because I love that she has the King Bradley sign over there. when you guys first read this script, how scared were you of this?
I was reading it from the point of view of Damien. So I guess I'm not so much scared for him, but excited for him. That's, again, showing my warped mind when you see the first episode. I think I sort of felt like embracing him as opposed to being scared of him. I think, just see the situation he's in and you just think, poor guy.
He's right, because the same thing. For me, because I thought people will identify with Damien because he's blacked out who he really is. That's how he survived all this time. And to be faced with the idea of being the Antichrist, it's like if you guys found out you were the Antichrist, what would you do? And it's so intriguing.
Get an Apple Watch.
Wait, I'll take over the world.
Yeah, there's clearly, there must be a process of like acknowledgement, acceptance when he's presented with this information. Christ is not just like, ah, oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like me? So, Damien in this is a war photographer.
Yes.
And we talked about this earlier. There's a photography kind of theme in the original film that you're working with as well, correct?
Yeah, if you watch the original film, you know, there's a photographer, the character of Jennings, and I'm probably wrong about this, but I think, at least as far as I can remember, you know, he takes pictures, he takes a picture of a priest at the birthday party, and then later you see, you know, the priest gets killed, a steeple falls through him, or falls off a church, and when he develops the picture, he sees a black line. And I think that's one of the earliest examples of, you know, photography and supernatural colliding in a movie. It had probably been done before that, but that was the first time I had seen that. So I started thinking about, oh, there's something in this character, in this world's DNA, and the fact that, you know, if Damien is supposed to bring about an apocalypse, a war, let's say, so there's something about that, and his approach and what he's been doing as a war photographer, I think, shows part of the humanity, shows where he's been, and it's something that we take very seriously, and that we've been able to develop his character through that. So it was a seed that, when I was thinking about what I love about that original movie, it was something that then as I kind of pulled into the script, it sort of kind of really fought for a lot of space. So it was fun to use that.
And you were also, from the clip we saw, you know, the clip from the plant, the hanging plant scene and the bike, and he saved his tricycle, or someone has saved his tricycle, which is twisted. Will you be kind of giving any nods to other iconic moments from the film, like the steeple and the decapitation?
I love that film, so the more I can rip it off, the better.
All right, so this is your first Comic-Con since you worked on Walking Dead.
Yes.
All right, well, welcome back.
Thank you.
Yes. How different is it being here with a show that you've actually created?
You know, it's a lot of fun. I mean, you know, Walking Dead is a great experience, and I was brought into that show to you know, work on staff. And you know, it's based on a long-running, you know, comic book and everything. What's fun about this is, you know, this one movie exists, and now you can create these characters and build this world out. That's really just been a lot of fun.
Nice. And you've been working in TV, and you've worked with some incredible people all along. Did you recruit any old friends for this?
Yeah, I did, actually. You know, I was. We brought in a great director from Walking Dead, Ernest Dickerson, who did some terrific episodes. Jose Cantillo, who played one of the governor's henchmen, is in. We're using composer Bear McCreary, who's just fantastic. And when I decided to do the project, he was one of the first calls I made and said, oh, we need you to do this. And then there was, I'm happy to announce that, you know, Scott Wilson is a part of the show. So we actually have to have a clip, so let's...
All right, so tell me, what is Scott playing in this? What is his position here?
Why don't we just ask him?
Yeah! Mr. Scott Wilson! All right, Scott. Welcome.
No more Mr. Nice Guy.
All right, Scott, who is this guy? What are you doing here?
I just feel lucky to be here and be working with these talented actors, and with Glenn again and his wonderful writing and his wonderful writing team. So it's been exciting. From read the first script and I said, yeah, this is really good. So I'm looking forward to it.
Can you tell us anything about the character?
Well, he has known Damien's parents. He has known and Rutledge for a long time. He's kind of walks the corridors of power. He's a power broker. I think you won't know for a while who he is, and then you'll say, who is this guy? But it's it'll be fun, I think, for the audience, because the characters reveal themselves in interesting ways. It's interesting, isn't it, the situation that the world is in now. I think this is a perfect time for this show, because you look around the world and you see bad things happening. And this show will be talking and dealing with people and issues that raise those questions that I think all of us are asking.
Is he a human? Is he also human?
Is he human? Yeah.
I don't know, when you're dealing with shows about the son of the devil, I'm just like, who's what, you know? Who's gonna have cloven hooves? It is very strange to see you without the ponytail. What happened to Herschel's ponytail?
Well, I was talking to Glenn, and he was telling me about the role of John Lyons, and I said, man, I still have a ponytail. He said, it has to go. So I cut it off, and I'm going to auction the ponytail and donate the proceeds to the Actors Fund. So, yeah. So all of you can bid on it. And even if you don't bid on it, you can make a contribution to the Actors Fund. It doesn't have to be much. It could be $5, $10, $15, $20. You know, 20,000. Look like a prosperous group. But whatever, you know, whatever you can do, check it out. I'm not exactly sure when it will go on auction. You think that's a good idea or not?
You also have someone else who's coming onto the show playing a Vatican investigator, correct?
Oh yeah, we have a terrific actor named Robin Wygarth, who played Calamity Jane on Deadwood, and I've worked with her before. She's a brilliant actress, and she's coming in as someone sent from the Vatican to investigate strange happenings in the world of Damien. So we're excited to announce that she's joining the show as well.
Okay, so what we're picking up here is that this guy is going along. Poor photographer, bad stuff's happening around him. And then does it reach like a fever pitch, or does somebody finally say like, yo dude, you are jinxed?
Yeah, it's all of that, yeah.
And horror is huge on TV today, obviously. But it's not always successful. It's very hard to keep the horror concept and the scares going on a week-to-week basis. How do you plan to actually keep that tension and those chills delivering every week?
Well, that's a really fun challenge. You know, what was so exciting about the original film is it feels like it takes place in our world. You know, it's not very special effects heavy. You know, it feels somewhat plausible. It just feels like there's a tremendous amount of bad luck in this world. But it feels grounded and it feels real. So, you know, the writers and I have worked really hard to kind of make sure that, you know, we have these interesting, fun horror sequences, but that feel plausible, you know? So we're always trying to work within the rules of that original film. And it's been tricky, but when you get it right, and hopefully we do, it comes together and it's been fun. And so that way, as long as we keep things grounded, and really invest in our characters, because, you know, we all watch TV because of the characters that we love. And so if we really care about Damien and the people in his world, I think people will go along for the ride. So, you know, that's really what we've been focusing on.
That might be the greatest challenge a writer could have, is making this character sympathetic. Like, when he was 5, it was one thing.
But now he's like this hot jack dude who's, you know, like, how do you not hate that guy? But, you know, like, how are you planning to do that? How am I going to turn on the show and be like, I feel bad for this guy. He's the devil, but I feel bad for him. He's got daddy issues.
Yeah, he's got daddy issues. He's Bradley James, he's Morgan, you know, so it's not that hard to do. But, you know, it's my friend the Antichrist. So.
Your friendly neighborhood Antichrist.
He's a wacky neighbor.
Right? So you're setting it in New York.
Yes.
But filming in Toronto. Mm-hmm. Why set it on the East Coast? Why in Metropolis? Because the original was London, correct?
Yeah, and I think Damien's been based out of New York, you know, as a lot of photographers may be, and you know there is a world element, so we will see him, you know, out in the world, and where we I think have, you know, really trying to make sure. I mean, part of the reason of that, say the Vatican is investigating, you know, the Antichrist would be a world problem, and that's something really important. The fact that he's a war photographer, we really want the show to have scope.
Okay.
So it's not just, you know, the parking meter is not working or something really small. It's got to be a world stage problem.
It's like genocide. Yeah. Oh, Damien was here. Yeah. And the tone, you're obviously keeping it grounded, but the original film had such like a kind of like a Baroque, almost like this operatic feel of like everything was very heightened. Is that something you're going for as well?
Yeah, that's important. I mean, we certainly want that, and a lot of that has to do with the music. You know, I mean, that's such an incredible score by Jerry Goldsmith, and you know, and why you had a lot of conversations with Bear about that. And so, you know, music is a huge element. It creates so much and just gives you that feeling of you know, impending horror. So we've really, you know, we've been able to get great directors in, and the cast is doing a great job. So we're, you know, it's I really hope that people find the show scary, thrilling. Hopefully it'll make you uncomfortable. That's what I always go for. So I'm proud of it.
Did you guys do like a group screening of the original film? Have you seen the original film? What did you think?
It's a very good film. I'd seen it originally when I was far too young to understand
Okay. Really
what was going on. But then when I watched it relatively recently, I was still probably too young to understand it, but it made a bit more sense.
Right. Does it fill in some of his backstory for you?
I think because we leave Damien there when he's 5 years old, and I dare say that everyone in this room is a much different person to when they were 5 years of age.
Have you seen some of the costumes?
That's a very good point. That's a very valid point. And so with that 25-year gap, you have a blank canvas to create the character. So the foundations are there for the story, but maybe not necessarily for Damien and how he operates.
Are we going to get to see like doctored pictures of Bradley when he was younger, wearing like the little, you know, the shorts and the jacket and
hat? That's a good idea, maybe.
Yeah. That's going to end up in fan fiction in about an hour.
Okay.
Yeah. Barbie, you actually did. You were doing horror movies at the time, because you did The Entity right around. That's right.
Was around then. I'm pretty bad with chronology, but yeah.
It was around that same era, and that movie was messed up. So scary.
Yeah, it's scary.
Yeah. How do you feel horror has changed since then?
Well, that film, like The Omen, was character oriented. It's, I think the thought is that if you care about the characters, then you care about what happens to them, so therefore it's more scary. And so I think they relate in that way, which the show does too.
Yeah, that movie though, I mean, God, if you guys have not seen The Entity, rent it, download it, whatever, watch it during the day, with people. And Scott, you've been doing horror for a while now. You've gone from the frying pan to the devil's kitchen.
Yeah, it keeps getting hotter, doesn't it?
Yeah. How is the different? How's the gauge here?
It's fun. I mean, you know, when you look at a script, you're looking at character development. and looking at what the overall script is about. And do you get a chance to explore the character? And that's what you have here, and that's as an actor, that's what you're looking for. So it happens to be based on something that's well known as a fan base, which is most likely good for the show. So I'm very curious to see what happens and to see if I lose any limbs. I mean, limbs likes to take legs off.
Have you talked to or heard from Richard Donner?
No, I have not.
He directed the original. Sometimes people get a little possessive. What are you doing to my movie?
No, I believe some of our producers have reached out and people are supportive of this. They've gone back to this story. I mean, it is an iconic character and a story, and they've gone back and obviously done the original sequels, and I think they've tried to pick it up. But people are supportive of us doing this.
And we talked earlier about, in addition to Bear's music, your director for the pilot. What he brought to it.
Yeah, Shekhar Kapoor is just a world-class director. He directed Cate Blanchett in Elizabeth, and he's just a really phenomenal director and has become a good friend. And, I met him, and it was just a regular meeting, just agent set it up. He came in, and he had read the script, and he said, "I love the script. I'd like to direct it." I said, "Really? Well, you're a real director, and I couldn't imagine you directing one of these scripts." And so I said, okay, and it was just a great honor. And we started talking about it, and the way he moves the camera in Elizabeth, where Elizabeth is always part of a conspiracy, and the camera snakes around her, and she always has there's always these odd angles that you never know who's watching her. That was something he brought to this. So not only did we look at the original film, but there was something already in his work, and the way that he was using the filmmaking to create tension, but also to establish the character, was really just something I had not experienced before. I mean, he was just really just a joy to work with, and we were lucky to have him.
Whenever the subject of the paranormal, the supernatural, anything like that comes up, film and TV actors, they always have some kind of like ghost story from production. You guys, did anything weird happen while you were filming? Has anything happened yet?
We've got this scene. I don't want to give it away. It's not a big scene, but we have a scene that involves a bird. Okay. So, and what happened was, a bird was in my house and crashed into the window. Now, how a bird got in my house, I don't know. Okay. And then I picked the bird up, and the bird died in my hands. An hour later, there was a different bird, another bird, that was also in the house that was dead. So someone's leaving dead birds in my house. So then we had a director who was jogging who was attacked by a bird. There was someone else who found a dead bird in their yard. And there have been about 10 to 12 instances of people and crew members working on Damien, in which have over 2 months, there's been all these dead birds in our lives. So that's one or two is weird, three, four. Then after a while, like, who's attacking us with dead birds? And it's just really been weird. And this has been both in LA and Toronto, and everybody's got a bird story.
Birds.
I didn't even know LA had birds.
Yeah, well, there were only two, and they're gone. They were gone.
What about you guys? Any creepy tales from the set?
No, touch wood. I mean, nothing to rival a bird story like that.
Nothing yet.
Give it time. Anything that you have, from the scripts, anything that you've read where it's just chilled you?
You know, there's so much that I've read. The thing that always knocks me out about Glenn's writing and his guidance of the writers is how astounded I am all the time, how surprised I am at every turn. I don't think this is whatever you think the Omen is or the Antichrist is. This is surprisingly so much more. I read each script not knowing what's coming. I was reading one last night, I'm just pure audience, you know, because I'm reading it, because I'm that surprised. And that's really rare.
And this is something, it's a hot button issue. I mean, outside we've got protesters with their yellow signs. I'm like, that's weird cosplay, whatever. Any concern with upsetting the religious right, the Christians, the... anybody? Everybody?
No, not really. You know, I'm sure those people watch TV. I hope they watch too. You know, but you know, I mean, I was raised Catholic. I have an uncle who's a priest. So you know, we're really kind of examining stuff that's in the Bible. We're examining a lot. You know, but it is an entertainment too. It's a horror show. So you know, and it's drawing from an iconic film. So I'm interested to see what people have to say, because we are taking things seriously.
And it depends, it relies on some, the reversal, you know, of certain sacred designs, elements, you know, icons, things like that, and, you know, can be seen as profane and all that stuff. Are you ready for
it? Yeah, I'm ready for it. I mean, that's what I do. So, you know, I mean, but, you know, I think good horror has to be profane, to be honest. It has to be sort of shocking, not gratuitous or shocking for, you know, shock value, but it's there to elicit a strong visceral emotional response. So, you know, I think in my career I've always been interested in sort of, you know, telling stories that make people uncomfortable, that push the envelope, and certainly, you know, if I'm gonna work on a show about the Antichrist, that's just a lot there to mine. So. It's not for everybody, but you know, it definitely has a strong point of view, I'll say that.
And how weird is it to be working on something for all of you, where, well, actually, Barbara, you would be used to this, doing a project that where the source material is the Bible. You know, you're going to, because you're obviously relying on things that are in the Bible from the book of Revelations and all that, correct? So, and Barbara, you've already done,
you know. Been there, done that.
Yeah. So have you guys, did you guys like read this stuff from the Bible to see what's up?
The book of Revelation. Yeah, I've read the book of Revelation.
I mean, it's creepy stuff. Yeah. Did you read any of this?
No.
You don't want to shake?
For me at this stage, there was a relative, oh, there's someone holding the sign for you then.
Oh, thank you.
There you go. There's a relative reason for it. A lot of what you'll discover in the show is about discovery for Damien. And so knowing too much as an actor puts you in danger of anticipating things. So there's a lot of discoveries that I'm making at the same time, because then you get that for free.
I will say that the tone that we're going for is like the original film. So it's, you know, because it's a TV show, you can work in these moments. But we never play this for camp. There's never a wink. You know, it's always taken seriously. I mean, I really don't look at that original movie and see a lot of humor in it.
Absolutely.
You see the humanity. But but if it's, you know, this is a show that can get pretty bleak pretty fast. So you need that humanity. You need that levity. You need those moments. And fortunately, we have, you know, in season one, 10 episodes now where you can kind of push in so that it's. You know, yes, you want to create tension where the world's closing in, but if it gets too bleak, I think, you know, that's not really a show we're interested in making either. It's about the humanity.
Thanks. And just for you guys, last question from me is, do you have a favorite on-screen devil?
Can you name some on-screen devil?
There's a very attractive one in the form of Elizabeth Hurley once upon a time.
Yes. Yes. There was South Park. I think the Simpsons had. They've got the devil.
Supernatural. Al Pacino.
I was going to say Al Pacino. I was going to say Al Pacino. but I may go to South Park.
What about John Huston, and what was the devil in Daniel Webster?
John
Huston Sr. John Huston Sr. John Huston, the director's father, was the devil.
The episode with the Ferrari head, actually, now it's the devil orders a Ferrari head for his birthday in South Park.
Oh, yes.
And he hires three serial killers to get them, and they end up messing things up. It's gross and disgusting, but brilliant.
Okay, well, clearly South Park's Satan wins. All right, well, listen, thank you guys. Let's give a big round of applause.